Hi, folks. Ryan Honeyman here from Lyft Economy. Many folks have come to us over the last 10 years and asked, how do I get more involved in creating an economy that works for the benefit of all life? They also ask, what skills and experiences do I need to help make this transition? So 3 years ago, we created something called the Next Economy MBA to help address this and similar questions. Lyft Economy's Next Economy MBA is an online course that's designed for entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, students, recent graduates, employees, and folks who want to learn more about transformational next economy strategies and businesses. Join the growing alumni network of nearly 250 alumni who've gone through this program and learned essential skills and hopefully built lifelong relationships for catalyzing businesses in the emergent and regenerative economy. So we encourage you to check out our course. You can go to lifteconomy.com/MBA. The next course, Cohort 7, starts on September 21st, 2021. So once again, go to www.lifteconomy.com/MBA. And now, on with the show. Welcome to Next Economy Now. The goal of this podcast series is to highlight the leaders who are taking a regenerative, bioregional, equitable, democratic, racially just, and whole systems approach to creating the new economy.
Kate, welcome to the show.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
So Kate, let's give listeners a little bit of your personal background. Where were you born and raised?
Oh, so I was born, raised in London. I'm a London girl, grew up in the 1980s. And I think I was deeply influenced by what I saw on the TV in the 80s, actually. You know, Exxon Valdez spilling its oil into Alaska's waters, hole opening up over the ozone layer, Ethiopian famine. So by the end of my school days, as a teenager thinking about going to university, it was very clear to me that I wanted to help change the world and tackle these challenges. And I thought the best thing to do was to go to university and study economics because it was the language of public policy. So that's how I came to be studying economics in the first place.
And how did you first realize that economics could be harnessed for good?
Well, first I realized that I was deeply frustrated by economics, actually. I felt that the things that I cared about most seemed to be called externalities and were dealt with in a couple of sessions. They were on the margins of the mainstream of theory. And I found myself feeling really disillusioned with theory. In fact, after 4 years of study, when I left university, I didn't stay on and do a PhD as I had originally imagined I might, because I just felt I don't identify with this. And I don't want to call myself an economist, which is why I now call myself a renegade economist. I feel comfortable with that. But at the time, I thought I don't feel proud of this mindset that's been taught to me. So I tried to walk away from it and I immersed myself in real world challenges. I spent 3 years working in the villages of Zanzibar with phenomenal micro entrepreneurs who had little to rely upon but the forest and their community and raising their kids with no running water or no school nearby. I then worked 4 years at the UN on the Human Development Report, so taking a very top level global overview of humanity's progress and setbacks, and then joined Oxfam for a decade working on fair trade, supermarket supply chains and climate change. And it was through all of these experiences, as well, I should say, as becoming a mother of twins, that I realized that you can't really walk away from economics, because the world that we live in and all of those experiences I had are framed in terms of the economy and in terms of our interaction with it. So I decided I wanted to turn it to something good rather than just continually reject it. And so I decided to walk back towards economics, or around 20 years later, and I wanted to flip it on its head and say, what if we actually started with the values in the world that we actually care about, and then asked ourselves what kind of economic mindset would give us half a chance of realizing them? So it was when I started doing that and pushing aside my old textbooks, diving into new economic websites, blogs, conferences, businesses, practices, thinking there's such dynamic, exciting stuff going on in the world of economics. It doesn't actually usually get recognized as economics, but actually I think this is the evolving frontier of it, and I'm excited about how we could reclaim the idea of economics, which after all means household management, and how we couldn't need that more than ever now. Wise planetary household management for the 21st century. So I then decided I did want to call myself an economist, but a renegade one, and reclaim it as household management for the 21st century, searching out the exciting ideas that I think give us the best chance of thriving together on our planet.
And who were some of your early influences that shaped your thinking when you were sort of just getting into this space of renegade economics?
Well, I read Donella Meadows' Thinking in Systems, and that blew my head in one of those wonderful ways that you realize your thinking will never be the same again. I read a wonderful book by Marjorie Kelly on Owning Our Future, and I know she's recently been on this podcast, which again, Owning Our Future journeys into a generative economy, which again hugely influenced the way I could see the potential for using the design of business, the very structure of how a business is purposed, financed, and owned, can transform what business can do and make happen in the world. So that really influenced me. And then the work of John Fullerton at Capital Institute, his work on regenerative capitalism, meaning capitalism in a very holistic sense, the multiple human, social, natural, cultural capitals of life. Their work on regenerative thinking and reimagining the economy hugely influenced me. And I'll add one more, Janine Benyus's work on biomimicry. Again, thinking about how we could design our world so that it mimicked nature. And I got so excited when I first read her work. And the question that came to me was, if this is how designers can imagine creating new industrial designs, what kind of economic system and what kind of economic design would actually help to unleash that potential?
That's phenomenal. Yeah, John Fullerton has been on the podcast as well. I need to get Janine Benyus. That's a good reminder. That
you talked to you definitely need to get Janine Benyus.
Let's talk about this idea, some of the ideas in your book. Maybe could you help explain to folks your idea about donut economics and maybe just sort of a general overview of what that principle is?
Yeah, so let me tell you what the donut is. It's a ridiculous word in some ways to have at the heart of an economics book. And after all, donuts are sticky, fatty, sugary, and not really very good for us. So some people say, why did you call it the donut? But I like to say, perhaps this is going to be the one donut that actually turns out to be good for us. So imagine an American donut, bring it home, with a hole in the middle. It's the shape of the diagram that I drew back in 2011 when I was trying to draw a picture of what human well-being in the 21st century could look like. So think of that hole in the middle of the donut. That's a space of shortfall. It's a space where people are falling short on life's essentials, be it their access to food or water, electricity, decent housing, having political voice, healthcare, education. So it's all the essentials of life that people need so that they can lead a life of dignity and opportunity. And if we fall into that hole, we're falling short on life's essentials. So the inner crust of the donut is what you could call a social foundation for well-being. We want to get everybody out of that hole and into the actual donut itself. But we also know that the way that we humans put pressure on our planet actually jeopardizes the health and integrity of our planetary systems on which we depend. We depend for our well-being on a stable climate, on fertile soils, on healthy oceans, on ample biodiversity, on a protective ozone layer. And if we put too much pressure on the planet's systems and we start to kick these essential systems out of kilter, we actually risk jeopardizing the phenomenal, benevolent phase of the planet's history in which all of human civilization has evolved and thrived. So our well-being depends not only on meeting each person's needs for resources, as I described, but also keeping ourselves collectively within these boundaries of pressure on planet's essential systems. Leading Earth system scientists have drawn up these 9 planetary boundaries, including things like climate change, converting the land surface, using too much fertilizer in the form of nitrogen and phosphorus, biodiversity loss, chemical pollution, and they've tried to identify a level beyond which we shouldn't go in terms of that pressure. So if we go over beyond those levels, that's like shooting out beyond the outer crust of the donut. So the inside hole is where we fall short on life's essentials for people. Beyond the outer crust of the donut is where we overshoot pressure on the planetary boundaries. We need to get out of those two spaces and come into the donut-shaped space itself, where we can meet the needs of all within the means of our planet. And this century, I can think of no greater challenge that we could take on to meet the needs of over 10 billion people within a thriving planet. To me, this is the challenge of the 21st century. It's the generational challenge we should take on. And it's what well-being would look like in the 21st century if we have the wisdom to pursue it. So that's the donut concept. When I first published that donut, when I worked for Oxfam in 2012, I was completely gobsmacked. That's a very English word for you. I was completely amazed by the reaction to it. It's a picture. But the number of people who started tweeting it and presenting it and contacting me saying, this is how I've always thought about sustainability. I've just never seen the picture before. And I realized then the power of pictures, the power that they have to shape our frames and shape the way we think, confirm our paradigms for us, and that they go deep into our visual cortex at the back of our heads and stay there long after the words have faded, long after the equations of theory have drifted off. So pictures really matter. And it gave to me two questions. One, if getting into the donut, that safe and just space for humanity, is the 21st century challenge, then what kind of economics gives us the best chance of getting there? What economic theories would you want today's students in universities all around the world to be learning if they're going to be good household planetary household managers this century? And the second question was, if this donut image has been so powerful in stimulating debate and helping to redefine our idea of sustainable development, then what other images are shaping the way we think about what the economy is and is for, and who we are in it, and how it moves, and what's the role of growth? And that sent me pelting back to my economics textbooks, poring over their pages, pulling out the diagrams that I thought I'd long forgotten, but they were sitting right there in the back of my mind with this deep sense of recognition. And I was asking myself, how have these little pictures that I didn't really give much credence to at the time shaped the way I think and shaped the way that every economic student is taught to think? So the heart of my book is going back over that visual framing of 20th century economics. What are the core pictures that we're taught, and how are they actually misleading us, giving us blind spots or false assumptions? If we want to write a new economic story, we need to change the pictures too. And so my book sets out to tell the new economic story in new pictures.
I love it. And I think many of the listeners here would say, great, I'm on board. And so what do you say to someone, maybe they're a small business owner, or so what's the implementation side? Like, someone says, great, how do we do it?
So I think, so it's wonderful that we always want to jump into doing things, but sometimes the most powerful thing we can do is change the way we first think. And that's why I've gone back to the deep roots of the paradigms. But one of the ways we can actually say, right, what does it mean to do it? I can tell you that story from my experience of presenting the donut diagram to many businesses, Fortune 500 companies, FTSE 100 companies, because I teach at executive education at the Cambridge Institute for Sustainability Leadership. And so over the past 5 years, I've presented the donut diagram time and again to businesses. And it's been really interesting hearing the reaction from them and from other businesses when they are presented with the donut and see this is a 21st century challenge. And I would say there are maybe five levels of response. Shall I just run through them?
Sure.
Okay. So the first one I would say, and I'm going to start from the bottom. The first one is on seeing the donut and that challenge of meeting the needs and rights of all within the means of the planet. The first one is, as a business, I do nothing. It's not my job, right? That's not what business is for. It's the old Milton Friedman idea that the business of business is business. So until somebody changes the law, changes the regulations, I'm going to carry on doing what I'm already doing. And I think this was a very prevalent attitude in the 1980s and 1990s and even in the early 2000s. But through my work at Oxfam, certainly I encountered more and more companies who were producing sneakers, producing clothing, producing beer, grapes, wine, supermarket goods all around the world, absolutely aware that in the face of climate change, in the face of water stress, the idea of saying, it's not my problem, I'll do nothing, was absurd, because the problem was hitting them right in their own supply chains. So you saw companies realizing, actually, I can't do nothing. I have to respond. I have to engage and make my own supply chains resilient first. So the do nothing attitude, I think we're hopefully seeing a goodbye to that. The next level up is, okay, I'm going to do what pays. I'm going to brand my products green if I can see that I'll get a consumer markup because I've got this niche green branding. I'm going to carry out cost efficiency measures through my supply chain because I see I can call it reducing my carbon footprint, but actually it will save me money. So only taking measures that I can see a short-term immediate payoff to do. So that's doing what pays, and it's the first step towards greening the supply chain. But of course, it falls far, far short of what can be done and what could ultimately be a very good business model. So then the third step that I've seen quite a number of companies arrive here, maybe get a little bit stuck here, is what I call do your fair share. And it's particularly in response to environmental pressures. So they say, okay, we need to reduce the world's carbon. How much do we need to reduce our carbon budget then by? perhaps I take my country's national carbon targets and I say I'll do my fair share of that cut. So my country says it's going to cut by 10% over 15 years. We'll cut by 10% over 15 years. We're doing our fair share. The problem with that is twofold. One, as we all know from when a group of friends tries to pay the bill at a restaurant, somehow putting in your fair share doesn't quite add up and it leaves us falling short. But also doing your fair share can very quickly slip into taking your fair share. So I've heard some companies respond to the donut, to the idea of, say, a climate budget or a fertilizer budget or a water budget, saying, how much can we take? How much of that carbon pollution is ours? How much chemical pollution can we put into the world? So how, looking for my fair share of that polluting budget. And if we get stuck there, we're never going to make that transformative breakthrough to regenerative thinking that we need. So let's go further up. Now we've gone from do nothing to do what pays, to do your fair share. Now we're starting to get more transformative. And I've called the next one up, do no harm. It's also sometimes called mission zero. We're going to have zero carbon emissions. We're going to put no waste, no dirty wastewater into the river. So it's transformative, certainly in terms of design and ambition. And yet, as I think William McDonough has said very eloquently, it stops short in a strange place. If we can manage to do zero harm, why wouldn't we stick our heads through that glass ceiling of imagination and actually go to the fifth level and be generous and give positively? So go net positive. And I like to call it being generous, because that word comes from the inspiration of Janine Benyus. She talks a lot about generosity and creating generous cities. So asking not how much value can we extract from this supply chain or from this system, but how many benefits can we layer into it so that we can give some away? I think that's a genius question and a genius way of looking at the future of the world that Janine Benyus gave to me. And then the question is, what kind of design of a business enables a business to have that attitude, to be generous and to be generative, looking for net positive contributions to society, to environment, to the neighborhood, to suppliers through the supply chain, and asking how many benefits can we layer into this so we can give some of those away and still make a fair return. So we went from do nothing to do what pays, to do your fair share, up to do no harm, and then breaking through to this transformative idea of being generous. Those are the five levels of responses I've seen. And of course, it's not a ladder. We don't have to climb it up it step by step. In fact, we don't have time to climb up it step by step. And some companies have jumped right up to do no harm or even to be generous. You can make that transformative leap, and it's a mindset leap. So I think it's a very exciting time to watch companies who are beginning to see the potential of being generative and being net positive in the world. And some of them even say, we want to be a donut brand. We want to show that the core business practice that we engage in, the very thing that we set out to produce in the world, is actually helping move humanity into the donut space. So I'm really excited by the way companies have responded to the donut and also seeing it as a transformative concept.
I love that idea. And especially, I can definitely resonate with how business owners and organizations react. And I think you're right. We need people on each of those five levels, as long as they're quickly moving upwards towards the
fifth. The question is, where are you going? Like, what are you aiming to do now? And where are you going? Don't get happy just sitting there, but where are you going next? Yeah.
You know, something that I've been thinking about in the last few weeks, which I'll run by you, is one of the challenges we've identified at Lyft Economy is people don't actually know what an economy that works for all life actually looks like in detail. For example, I remember when I was applying to jobs several years ago, there's this book called What Color Is Your Parachute? I don't know. Have you ever heard of that book?
I have heard of that book.
And so he talks about, you know, when you're applying to a job, you need half the information that you think about what's out there and twice the information about yourself. And what you really need to do is create in detail what your dream job looks like. So where do you want to live? What kind of income you actually need? What type of people you want to work with? What your top skills are? And I was sort of thinking, for our economy, we often vote for things like, oh, I want to vote for Hillary, or I want to vote for Bernie, or I want to vote for Trump. But we're sort of directionally voting without actually describing in detail what this end result is. You know, so I'm wondering if you've, for example, is it more worker-owned? Is it all companies or worker-owned cooperatives in 500 years? You know, that's fully integrated, vertically integrated regenerative farming. You know, I think that there seems to be a bit of a gap between like this sort of directional intention versus what does it actually look like when we've succeeded? And do you have any thoughts on that idea?
Yeah. So I would say we have no idea what it'll look like when we've actually exceeded. And that's, to me, that's fine. Because if we try to pin down what it would look like, we're going to be definitely wrong. I mean, the rate of innovation, of new business design, of brilliant new technologies that desalinate seawater using sunlight, the new possibilities of how we can provision to meet everybody's needs within the means of the planet are fantastic. So I wouldn't try to pin down, but rather, again, go back to Donella Meadows and say, you know, embrace complexity. Embrace the fact that this is going to be a messy, joyful ride, that there are going to be many ways in which a particular problem is solved. There's not going to be one particular solution, and there will be a real danger of getting attached to one solution and then hammering that one home, because in different communities, in different cultures, in countries with very different resources, ways of organizing, different things could work. Some in one community, something could work by being organized in the commons. In another place, it could work through the market. Another place, it could be run by the state. So we've got these diverse ways of provisioning: the market, the household, the commons, and the state. I think of them as the four contributing provisioning systems to the economy, and we can mix and match between them. So I don't want to try and pin it down, actually, because I think we definitely sell it short in our minds. What I've tried to focus on is, what are the economic principles that should drive our search? And John Fullerton's done wonderful work on this as well, coming up with 8 regenerative principles for an economy. And so those could inspire people's thinking. In my work, I tried to take, I'll put 3 forward here. 1, embrace complexity. Realize that the economy is ever evolving. Of course, it's in the 20th century, and most economic students still today are told that the economy is best modeled in equilibrium, that it resettles to this equilibrium point. It's actually completely the wrong kind of science. We should embrace complexity science and evolution. And that I find very empowering, because if the economy is always evolving, it means that each one of us can be part of its evolution. And the innovations, you know, if you have a friend who's setting out to run a worker-owned co-op, working through the collaborative commons and then building a market platform on top of that, that innovation is part of the evolution of the 21st century economy, and they're actually helping to reshape where the whole thing goes. So I find complexity and that joyful mess of it all really empowering for each one of us. And we can ask ourselves, how does the way that I shop, travel, eat, vote, volunteer, demonstrate, and save my money, how do each of those ways affect humanity's ability to come into the donut? Because each of those ways is part of a pattern in this solution. But while embracing this idea of complexity, I've focused my work around saying we need to design the economy and its structure so that it's distributive. We've all heard far too much about the rise of the 1%, and we've seen the effects of that. And we want to move away from this currently divisive economic design we have to redesign finance and business and wealth ownership so it's distributive of the value that's created, and also so that it's regenerative, so that it's regenerating businesses, actually helping to regenerate the processes on which life depends. So to me, those two principles: how can we make a business be distributive of the value it creates, blaring in so many benefits we can give some away or share them out through all those who help create it? And how can we design businesses so that they help to regenerate the very processes of life on which we depend? And with those two in mind, I find myself that it's almost like a divining rod with these two steering sticks. There's going to be tensions and choices between them. There's going to be many ways of doing it. But I find using driving principles rather than fixating on particular solutions at this point is more likely to get us there. Of course, we can all look around the world and see examples of companies or communities or complementary currencies or open source digital tools or open source design websites. Wonderful. The Open Building Institute has wonderful shared designs of how to build an eco house that can be adapted to any context around the world. We can point to these wonderful designs. They embody these design principles, and it's lovely to see the possibilities of this new future coming through. But I'm not going to try and be the one who draws the picture, because I would rather be surprised by what the next generation create.
I love that answer. It's almost like using your core value, like a lot of companies use their core values to guide the decisions as opposed to mandating certain actions. But if you sort of have these core values as your North Star, it sort of can guide you.
Yes. Yes.
What about this question? I think this is maybe at the core, is, do you think an economy that works for all life is actually possible? And that's a bit of a, and then if so, how long do you think it will take us to get there? Because, you know, looking back over human history, we've got some tarnish on our reputation. So do you think it's actually possible for us to create an economy that works for all life?
Well, it's a mighty fine ambition, and we should never lower our sights beyond such an ambition. Your lovely phrase, an economy that works for all life, I think closely connects with the phrase I use, which is, can we live within the donut? Can we live within the social and planetary boundaries that meet the needs of all within the means of our planet? So when I think like that, I certainly believe, I can't prove it to you, but I don't think anyone can disprove it to me. I believe that we more than 10 billion humans this century can indeed meet all of their needs and rights so that everyone can lead a life of dignity, opportunity, and community within the means of our planet so that we protect the life support systems. It's not easy, though. I mean, let's not kid ourselves that that's an easy task. It's not easy, first of all, in terms of the design of how we actually do that, ensuring that everybody has clean water, then ensuring that everybody has access to sufficient food and that it's grown in ways that they have a secure access to that food. So it's not at all going to be easy, but one of the major challenges, I think, is overcoming our inheritance of 20th century economic design, because I think we are locked into institutions and industrial processes that are actually degenerative by design. I mean, look at mainstream industry. It takes Earth resources, makes them into stuff we want, we use it for a while, and then we throw it away. That's a linear, cradle-to-grave degenerative process, and yet that is the mainstream of the way business is done. How do we transform that to make it regenerative? It's a huge challenge, not in terms of the process. In fact, I find architects and designers are the ones running to do this. It's the economics that's holding them back. And Janine Benyus gave me a wonderful example on this. She said she was working with a developer in a major emerging economy city and they wanted to make it a regenerative new urban development. And she said, they brought her in, she said, great, we can even make buildings that take in the city's dirty air, clean that air, circulate it to the residents of the building, and put it back out in the city cleaner than it was in the beginning. There's Janine Benyus, be generous right there. And the reply of the city developer was, but why would I do that? Why would I provide clean air for the rest of the city? And it's not that that person was a bad man who couldn't see generosity, but the whole structure of incentives that were behind him and shaping his behavior as a development financier were saying, extract as much value as you can. He didn't face incentives that said, layer in so many benefits, you can give some away. So it's transforming the economics of short-term shareholder returns, of this tight financial rate of return on money, on the positive interest that's always designed into money, the strict incentives by which business people are typically judged, the quarterly returns that companies are always feeling under pressure. All of these systems are actually shaping and narrowing the possibilities of economics. So I see industrial design or urban design or product design running ahead with the possibility of creating an economy that embraces and respects all life, but that the economic systems we've created are holding it back. So there's a real tension between regenerative design and old economic thinking.
On a more sort of mixed note, I guess, how has Brexit and the election of Donald Trump affected your work?
Oh, well, they're connected, aren't they? Because the connection I see between them, first of all, I'll start there. The connection I see between them is that they've got both of our countries, the UK and the US, spinning in very specific debates around questioning our policymakers, questioning very traditional economic indicators. So, for example, in the UK, some years ago, David Cameron, who was still from the Conservative Party, started talking about, what if we went beyond gross domestic product and even started to measure gross national happiness? You know, he put a foot in the water of that new debate. That was where the atmosphere was at. We're now at a time when, because the government is saying, right, we're going to take the UK out of Europe, and so many advisors have said this is against our economic interest, I feel that we've come into a very narrow economic debate about, are we showing that we're getting quarterly growth? So tight focus on what's happening to GDP quarter to quarter. We're going backwards into very old, stripped bare metrics. And again, in the US, you see the same thing. In the run-up to his election, Donald Trump started to say, he dropped all the nuance that I've been hearing every time political leaders talk about growth over the last decade. Many of them have talked about sustained growth, sustainable growth, green growth, smart growth, good growth, clean growth. All these lovely adjectives put in front of growth, showing that we want something more nuanced than mere growth. Trump has stripped those away, and he said, I'm pro-growth. So he's just gone back to that bald narrow assumption. And he was saying in the run up to the elections, we're going to deliver maybe 4% growth. When I heard that, I thought, I know exactly who you're channeling. In 1960, President John F. Kennedy was elected on a ticket promising 5% growth to the American people. And the story goes that as soon as he was elected, he turned to his economic advisors and said, do you think we can deliver on that 5%? And this was because in the 1960s, this was the hot moment of GDP competitiveness. You had the US and the USSR competing to see who could turn out more stuff. It was the heyday of GDPism. And it was, of course, before Rachel Carson had even written Silent Spring, long before we even understood about climate change. So the idea that you could go for growth seemed to have no limiting drawbacks to it. So there's Trump channeling this message from Kennedy. Kennedy said, I go for 5% growth. Trump's slightly turning it down, but still saying, I'm going to go for 4% growth. So I really worry that both in the UK and the US, Brexit and the election of Trump and all the turmoil that I'm certainly seeing from across the pond around that is drawing us into a much narrower old economics. And I really worry because it's drowning out the space for nuance and a much richer kind of rethinking of what the economy is and is for. So it's all the more important that those of us who are in this space don't just get dragged into saying what's wrong with Brexit, saying how we don't like Trump, how we want to change things, how we don't like the way he's doing things, but rather, as again, channeling Nella Meadows, keep speaking to the paradigm you stand for. Keep using the language that you do believe in, that resonates for you. Keep framing things, draw the pictures that resonate for you so that you're not constantly responding to something you disagree with, but you're continually proposing something that you believe in. So when I heard when Brexit happened and then when I heard Trump was elected, my very first thought was, oh, this pushes my book and the vision of my book just off the agenda. And then the next day I woke up and I thought, no, it's even more important now. It's even more important that we come forward with a clear, coherent agenda that many of us start to believe in and share language, share pictures, because then we can really put it forward as an alternative vision.
You know, one of the things I've been struggling with, I'm curious to hear your thoughts on this, is this idea of, you know, at least in the U.S. with recent executive orders, you know, there's a lot of folks in the new economy space who are balancing this idea of how much do we continue to do the work, you know, working towards building the next economy, and when do we actually get up out of our desks and go outside and hold a sign and protest, you know, or it's sort of like the stop versus the build the next economy. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on does Brexit or the election of Trump or other current political kind of strife affect how folks working in the new economy should be thinking about their sort of daily or you know, their day-to-day actions?
Oh, great question. I would say that over recent decades, the particularly neoliberal framing of economics and economic language that's been so predominant since the election of Thatcher and Reagan has brought in a language that has told us that we are predominantly consumers. So often you'll hear, you know, is this good for consumers and consumer interests? We're not consumers, we're citizens, we're people, we're neighbors, we're friends, we're community members, we're voters. We have multiple identities. And so although we may find ourselves in the workplace as business owners or producers in one part of our identity, we are also voters and protesters and citizens holding our governments to account. And I think it's really important, just as I was saying earlier, we need to recognize that the economy has these different provisioning systems that interact. You've got the market and the state, the commons and the household, and we actually switch between all four of them and in and out of them every day. We need to remove this story that we've been told that we are primarily consumers and take back control over all of our multiple identities and say, actually, during my working hours, I may be a producer, a business owner, but then when I go home, I'm a voter, I'm a citizen, I'm going out to community meetings, I'm actually on a demonstration or on a protest. So I think it's really important to recognize the way, as I said earlier, the way we invest and we volunteer and we bank and we vote, they all shape the economy, not just the way we spend our money. But I'll finish this response by saying that one of the quotes that's inspired me most and really inspired the way I wrote this book was from the wonderful Buckminster Fuller, who said, to change something, it's not enough just to fight the existing model. To change it, you need to build a new model that makes the old one obsolete. So the work that people are doing in the new economy is part of building a new model that makes the old one obsolete. And it would be terrible if people said, oh, this is now irrelevant, I need to put this on the side and completely focus on protest. Because one of the best ways of protesting is to show a brilliant alternative example and to show a younger generation a positive image and model of the kind of economy that they want to be part of. So doing new economy work is, I'd say, a form of protest because it's building the new model that makes the existing one obsolete.
Yeah, yep, I agree. I think it's sort of a both and. Protest, yes. And continue to build. Yeah. Another question is, besides your own book, because as a fellow author, I know that we often give away our own books, but what other book do you most often give away as a gift?
There's one book I give away as a gift often, actually, so I'm continually replenishing it on my shelf. It's a book by John Berger, who was a media theorist who actually died at the very start of this year. So it's very nice to mention his name here. He wrote a book in 1972 called Ways of Seeing. And I discovered it when I was working at the Human Development Report in New York. I'd come from Zanzibar to the crazy streets of Manhattan. And I was working on a Human Development Report, which was about consumption, consumerism and pollution. And I think maybe a lot of the thinking I have now certainly goes back to those days. And in the reading I was doing around it, I came across a reference to this little book called Ways of Seeing. I dug it out in some Barnes & Noble. And I remember walking around Manhattan, sitting on benches, reading this thing. And again, it's one of those moments that just blows your mind and changes the way you think completely. So John Berger was writing about the power of image. Particularly, he was writing about the power of image in art, the way that women are depicted in art, the power of reproduction of art, so that the Mona Lisa is not just this one painting in the Louvre in Paris, but it's on everybody's tea towel and fridge magnet and key ring. And what does reproduction do to the way we perceive art? But also there was a very powerful essay in there about the power of advertising and how images from art are used in advertising to create glamour and to convince us that through the constant repeated message made by every advertisement, they're in fact all making the same message, which is you will transform yourself by buying something more. And this had a huge impact on me again, and walking through Times Square and all the advertising around me. It went in so deep, and only when I came to write my book, Donut Economics, and I happened to draw this picture and everybody responded to it, it sent me spiraling back to John Berger's Ways of Seeing and realizing he had deeply influenced me. And again, how we see things shapes the way we think. I don't know, I'm sure you're familiar with George Lakoff, the cognitive linguist, who's written a wonderful book called Don't Think of an Elephant, because just when I said that, of course, you thought of an elephant. So his book is about how we use words and we should never repeat other people's verbal frames if we disagree with them. So if you don't like tax cuts, don't talk about tax relief, because it frames a tax cut for the rich as a relief, which is who could not want a relief? He said, you've got to find an alternative frame like tax justice, which totally reframes the idea of tax away from a burden to be taken away to a fairness and justice in society. And I love George Lakoff's work around visual framing, verbal framing. And I realized channeling John Berger, what I was doing was visual framing. And don't use the old diagrams of economics if they're sticking unhelpful, erroneous diagrams in the back of our heads. We need to draw our own new diagrams for the 21st century economy. So thank you to John Berger, whose legacy I think will go on and on. And it's a wonderful little book. I really recommend it. It's very short and it's full of pictures. And some of the essays in it are just pictures.
Phenomenal. I'm definitely going to get it now.
Good. I hope Barnes & Noble all over the US will be, sold out soon.
That's right. Maybe you're overestimating the size of our audience, but I appreciate
you. No. I'm sure they're a very, very powerful audience.
What do people never ask you that you wish they did?
Wow. I don't know. What do they never ask me that I wish they did? I don't know. I can't think of an answer to that. I tend to get asked all the questions I like in discussing. I'm sorry, I can't think of a great answer for that.
Maybe it's what's it like to raise twins? Because that's pretty hard.
Oh, my goodness. It was funny actually, because in the opening chapter of my book, I talked about, as I said to you earlier, I talked about all the influences that I went through. Once I left university, I walked away and I thought I was walking away from economics, and I worked in Zanzibar, then I worked in New York, and then I worked for Oxfam, and then I became a mother of twins. And one of the people reading my book, an older man, he said, why do you put this in here? This isn't relevant. Take that out. And I thought, oh, but it's so relevant. Because when I became a mother, and I'm very lucky, I have a completely equal partner who co-parents our children with me. He's also a writer. We work from home, so we're literally equally taking care of our children. But my goodness, particularly in the first year of life, they were exceedingly dependent, physically dependent upon me. So the amount of, think of it in terms of economic sense, the household, the care economy of the household suddenly became central, and it was the central to provisioning for these tiny babies. The amount of housework, nappies that need washing, clothes that need washing, food and bottles that need preparing, the housework went through the roof. Our income halved because I wasn't working. Our sleep definitely halved. And all sorts of politics arise around the presumptions that society makes and that you make about what women and mothers do and what fathers or other parents do. And it was when I became a mother that I really understood the power of gender and gender inequalities in a very, very genuine way. So that has really shaped the way I think about the role of the household economy in provisioning, because the crazy thing about mainstream economic theory is it takes labor, right? Labor as an input to production, as if working man can just appear at the factory gates, you know, ta-da, ready for work, fresh and prepared every day. Rarely asking the question, who washed the clothes, who made the dinner, who cleaned up after them, who trained that person, who trained them to potty trained them, who taught them to be sociable. And it goes all the way back to Adam Smith, because when he was writing his great work, The Wealth of Nations, and he wrote this famous line, it is not thanks to the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, and the baker that we get our dinner, but it is due to their self-interest. He was sitting there writing. Who was making his dinner? His mum. He had moved back in with his mum to write his book. I wish she had put his dinner on the table just as he wrote that sentence. Perhaps if she had done that, he would have not been able to miss the irony. He would have had to add in, oh, our dinner doesn't just come through the market exchange with the butcher, the brewer, and the baker. It also comes from the household economy and the work that is traditionally done by women. If he'd done that, if he'd written it into his book at that moment, he could have transformed the future of economics and wouldn't have left feminist economics as apparently a novel thing to be adding in the 1970s. So, mate, you got me going there. That's what I wish people ask, when understanding that the household is part of the economy. Of course, one of the problems is when I'm teaching this with students, male and female students, they are almost disembodied from the household. They're students, they're living on campus, their meals are provided, they don't have to get any kids out of school and out of bed and off to school in the morning, they don't have to care for their elderly parents. So it's quite hard for them to understand and take seriously the idea of the household, because they're almost disembodied from it. And I think it's only when they become older, settle down, maybe have children or run their own homes, that they start to see that the household is an essential part of the economy. And if we leave it out, we're leaving out one of the fundamental domains in which our well-being is cared for and developed.
I definitely resonate with that. I feel like I always intellectually agreed with feminism, and I always felt like I was a strong supporter of women. And then I had a daughter, and I was like, holy shit, the world is so unfair.
Right.
It sort of is very visceral as opposed to intellectual.
Yes.
So I very much resonate with what you just said.
Yeah, I have a daughter and a son. They're now 8 years old. And so it's been fascinating talking with them about the presumptions that society makes about why a girl would, you know, the things that people give them, the different toys that they give them, or the different comments that they receive. And it's been really fascinating trying to raise two children aware of this. You can't insulate them from it, though, because every time they step out of the house, they're immersed in the presumptions of a shoe shop where all the girls' shoes are pink. Why? I don't see adult women going around all wearing pink shoes. And trying to explain to them why the world is like this, but making them understand that they don't have to accept it, but they can challenge it. So it's a really tricky thing. Also explaining to them about climate change. I've always raised my children talking about climate change, just as we understand germs on our hands that we should wash off. We understand why we don't fly on holidays and we use the car as little as possible and we turn the lights off in the house because we don't want to create carbon pollution. And one day, my son nearly broke my heart. We were walking down the street. He was about 5 years old and he said, "Mommy, why do most people not care about carbon?" And what I could hear in that was that he had embraced this understanding. But when he was out in the world, he could see that he was surrounded by people who didn't. And he couldn't understand the disconnect between the worldview he was being taught and the world he was living in. And I think actually that, not just for a five-year-old little child, but we all are experiencing that, aren't we? Anyone working in this new economy space, the disconnect between the values that we want to embody in the enterprises we run, or in the way we talk and think, and the way we teach, and the values that we see that the world is run by. And how you sustain yourself and keep living by those values and working by those values, even though you see it sometimes flying in the face of a much more destructive pattern. I go back to Buckminster Fuller. Keep on building that new model until you can make the old one obsolete.
Yeah, you mentioned Buckminster Fuller, Marjorie Kelly, John Fullerton, Janaine Bayes. Are there other folks that you are watching and inspired by in this new economy space?
I was very inspired when I read Cradle to Cradle, designed by Michael Braungart and Bill McDonough. Again, really rethinking the role of, well, the possibilities of design that you can have. Who else is really inspiring me? Well, all the folks, David Bollier and people working on the commons, because I find often when I mention the commons, many, many people say, what is that then? I don't understand that. And you think, this is fascinating. We've, again, I think the neoliberal dominance of neoliberal thought and economic teaching has told us that the commons, well, they're tragic, right? The tragedy of the commons, that's about all we ever learn. And that's due to an article written by Garrett Harding in 1968, where he said, well, if you leave a field open and anybody can graze their sheep there, it'll get overgrazed. So the commons are tragic. And it was thanks to Eleanor Ostrom coming along and saying, well, hang on, that's strange, because I can go around the world. I can see people sharing a watershed in California, or farmers in Nepal sharing water between their rice paddies. They're actually doing a better job than the state. They're doing a better job than the market, and they're self-organizing. So this is a commons. And she researched what are the kinds of rules and institutions and criteria that they put in place to make this work. And so her work has actually shown that the commons can be a triumph. So I think that all those who are working on commons theory are doing us a huge service of bringing back into our lexicon and into our understanding and into our field of vision the fact that the commons is an enormously important part of social life. When we're in the street, the way we cross the street and the way we make sure we don't bump into each other, that's a culture of commons. The way we are polite to each other and let each other pass through doors, it's a commons culture. And of course, the rise of the digital commons, Linux software, Wikipedia, all sorts of open source and creative commons spaces has really made the case that the commons, they're not just fishing commons or grazing commons, but the 21st century commons is online, and it's incredibly powerful. And when it interacts with market-based enterprises, it can be extraordinarily lucrative as well as generative of open and free ideas and value. So commons theory, I think I'm going to land there and say those who are working on telling us new stories about the commons and helping us see it again in our daily lives, they're doing an invaluable service to expanding our idea of what the 21st century economy is and can be.
Well, I love, in the last few questions here, I definitely encourage folks to check out Donut Economics, 7 Ways to Think Like a 21st Century Economist, and that's by Kate Raworth. So Kate, what else can folks who are listening do to help support you? Like, what do you need right now to help grow the next economy?
Oh, wow. Well, that's a generous question, but honestly, I don't feel like I'm growing the next economy. I feel like I've drawn the pictures that might help tell the story of what I see others doing, because I'm just so inspired and excited by the new economic thinkers and doers who are setting up new enterprises, creating community complementary currencies, creating the commons and embodying this in their life. I know young people who've said, I'm going to live open source world for a year. I'm only going to use things that are open source. So I see the new economy thriving. And again, as I said earlier, if we embrace the idea that it's a wonderful, joyful, messy complexity, then these are the people who are evolving the front edge of the economy. I used to say the cutting edge, but that's a very mechanical last century idea. It's not a cutting edge. It's an evolving front edge. So I hope that the book I've written is bringing the new pictures to the new story, which helps put in context many of the things that are already going on. When the book comes out, I'm really excited because I've been working with a wonderful team, 4 different teams of animators who are based in London, Brooklyn, Edinburgh and Barcelona, and they make these wonderful stop motion animations that I found them on the web, and I said I'd love to work with you guys. I've been very fortunate to be funded by the Candida Fund, also a US-based fund, and I've got some money there to turn these 7 ways of thinking into short little animations. So once the book comes out, if people want to follow my Facebook page on Donut Economics or follow me on Twitter, I'm going to be posting those, a 60 to 90 second animation made by some of the top animators in the world, which will tell you with humor and wit how to think like a 21st century economist. So go check them out when they come out. The book comes out on the 6th of April. Check them out. They'll be coming out once a week. Spread them to your friends. I hope they'll make you smile or laugh, but also help us see the patterns of the economy. And this is one of the last points I suppose I want to make, is that the economy is full of patterns, distributive, cyclical, recurring patterns. And once we start to learn to see those patterns in the world, we can become more confident in creating that new world. Just as we have new design principles, those new patterns start to speak to us more often. And I hope in these videos, some of those will be made clear, and that we can make economics fun. We don't just have to call it a donut and talk about sticky, sugary, tasty snacks, but we can actually make it funny and witty and something you want to be part of changing, because Lord knows we need it.
And where can folks find maybe website or email and Twitter handle, just so folks can find you?
Yeah, so my website is www.katerayworth.com. And Raworth is spelled R-A-W-O-R-T-H. So it looks like Kate Raworth, but it's one of those funny English names where we stick a Y in it when we say it. So it's kateraworth.com. My Twitter handle is just at Kate Raworth. And Donut Economics on Facebook is facebook.com/donuteconomics. And I would love to interact with people, hear about new economy ideas that others are doing, because I think we all nourish ourselves when we get excited about all the things that are going on and start to see the patterns and similarities between our initiatives and realize we're not alone. We're part of a wonderful, thriving, growing network of new economic thinking and doing.
Well, thank you so much, Kate.
Next Economy Now is a production of Lyft Economy. To listen to all of our episodes, go to lifteconomy.com/podcast. That's lifteconomy.com/podcast. You can also sign up for our monthly newsletter at lifteconomy.com/newsletter. Please also rate and review our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.